صدق الله العظيم. الحمد لله، نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن سيدنا محمدًا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صلِّ وسلِّم وبارِك على سيدنا محمدٍ وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. You know, we just listened to two verses, one from Surah Al-Baqarah and the second one for Surah Al-A'raf. And these two verses give us an account of a dialogue that happened between prophets and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You notice in the Quran, the historical account or the stories that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to us in the Quran are not intended for entertainment. It's not something that you read and enjoy, you know. They actually have, you should draw out of them a serious lessons. And that is the objective why Allah subhanahu gave us this story. Because the best way to teach something is to give a story and the person learned a lesson from it. You can tell somebody, you can tell your child, you know, that lying is bad. But if you give him a story about somebody who lied and something bad happened to him, then the lesson of lying is bad sticks in his mind. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to us these accounts, they must include some important learning for us. You know. So the first account is an account from between Prophet Ibrahim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Allah. And Prophet Ibrahim was curious about how Allah resurrect the dead. How Allah, people who die, how can Allah subhanahu bring them to a life again? You know. And I want to imagine this situation. Actually, here is a slave, Sayyidina Ibrahim, no matter how great a prophet he is still a slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he is speaking to the Lord of the universe, the supreme master of the universe, and ask him a question for no reason other than satisfy his curiosity. You know, why? How Allah does these things? You know, what benefit Sayyidina Ibrahim will gain out of this question? But when you examine how Allah subhanahu responded to Sayyidina Ibrahim, you realize that Allah subhanahu did not discourage Sayyidina Ibrahim from the question by asking these questions. You know, in fact, actually Allah responded to him by a demonstration. You know, although Allah subhanahu know that Sayyidina Ibrahim will never use this knowledge for anything, but Allah subhanahu wants to show him how it is done, you know. And that's why they always say that curiosity is the essence of existence of human being. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not want to discourage us from being curious. In fact, that is how progress happened. You know, the miracle of the human being, actually creation of the human being, that they are curious. They want to know, you know, in this regard. And as this is, you know, a quote, curiosity is the essence of human existence. Who are we? Where are we? Where do we come from? Where are we going? All of these questions that any person have any sense of intelligence should be anxious about it and wants to know the answer for. But anyway, let's look to how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answered Sayyidina Ibrahim to satisfy his curiosity. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him, you know, he asked Sayyidina Ibrahim, remember, Sayyidina Ibrahim was not asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he is convinced that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can resurrect from the dead. That is given. That's not a question. That's not a doubt in the mind of Sayyidina Ibrahim. But Sayyidina Ibrahim was asking how, you know, how Allah does it. Allah could have told him, well, I said to be and it become. But that doesn't tell Sayyidina Ibrahim the process. And Sayyidina Ibrahim was looking for the process. So while Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala demonstrated to him the how by an experiment. What Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him has said, you know, take four kind of birds and bring them closer to you. Get these two birds attached to you, recognize you, and then put them apart in different mountains, in four mountains, and call them and they will come to you. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ends the verse, وَعْلَمْ أَنَّ اللَّهَ عَزِيزٌ حَكِيمٌ, that Allah is almighty, all wise. Now the interesting part, Sayyidina, there was no other question. What does this experiment mean? Sayyidina Ibrahim directly understood the process by which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala resurrected the dead. The question is, are we curious enough to know how? What did Sayyidina Ibrahim understood? You know, the experiment is in front of us, the details of it is given, but Sayyidina Ibrahim didn't follow the question because he understood. And we read it, the question for us, is it, you know, should we, what did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala demonstrate to Sayyidina Ibrahim? What is this process that the experiment, you know, actually proved? So before we go through this, let me go to another example, demonstrate how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala respect the curiosity of the human being. Here is the other verse from Surah Al-A'raf, and here Sayyidina Musa, you know, asking Allah, he was curious how Allah looks like. You know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could have told him, how do you dare you ask this question? Who you are to ask me this question? But no, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't reprimand him, didn't, you know, discourage him even from the question. By Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala satisfied his curiosity by also doing another experiment to him. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could have told him, you cannot see me. But no, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't do it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did an experiment, told him, in order to see me, you have to have power more than even the mountain. Your physical power, your physical construct have to be more powerful to stand seeing me. And therefore, what is the verse says? That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala exposed himself to the mountain and told him, if the mountain can stand still, then you will be able to see me. But as soon as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala exposed himself to the mountain became a heap of dust. So direct Sayyidina Musa, in this case, fell unconscious from not seeing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, just from that scene itself, you know. And so we have these two stories that in front of us, and there is actually many others in the Quran. In fact, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran always encourage the human being, encourage the believer to be curious and look for answer to something that they are interested in. You know, when we study, you know, the Quran, we find Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala encouraged, we all curious about where did we came from? How did Muslim, you know, how human being came to earth? What Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tell us, قُلْ سِيرُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ, Surah Al-Ankabut. You are curious about how you came from? قُلْ سِيرُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ فَانْظُرُوا كَيْفَ بَدْأَ الْخَلْقِ. You know how Allah, you want to know how I created? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, do you know how I created the whole creation? سِيرُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ, search, study anthropology. You know, study, learn, dig for fossils, find out. قُلْ سِيرُوا فِي الْأَرْضِ, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, and Allah, as he, كيف بدأ الخلق ثم الله ينشئ الناس الأخرى, as Allah created the first one, he can create, you know, the subsequent one. إن الله على كل شيء قدير, and Allah is capable to do anything. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't ask actually us to be curious, but to satisfy our curiosity, not because he is going to explain it to us, but he said, no, your responsibility now to find out, and this is how you can find out. And they say actually that the time when a person stop being curious is the time when he reach an old age. And this is an interesting, because in order to be a superior person, you have to remain young. You're young in heart, young in mind. So you always have to be curious Otherwise, and Allah expected this from the believers, because Allah subhanahu say, "Kuntum khayra ummatin ukhrijat linnas." You who sitting here are the best that Allah subhanahu brought to mankind. Then you just think about it. How are you going to be the best? Unless you always want to discover something, wants to advance, wants to be the leader in every aspect in this life, whatever aspect of life, in morality, in knowledge, in discovery, in advancement, in wealth. That is how can you become the best except through these things in front of, you know, of everybody. You know, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have created us and equipped us with this trait of curiosity. And this is why, who is the most curious? You find out the children. The children are the most curious. It is we who actually, you know, suppress this great trait from them. You know, and that's why when the child is young, what the child does? Always ask a question, once want to know. But the question is, do we help him develop this curiosity, or we try to, you know, basically stop it? And that is something that we as Muslims have to be very careful, actually, with our children, our grandchildren. And they always say, you know, how you preserve this children curiosity? One never discourage the child or ridicule, or at worst, you can ridicule him for any question. Even if he asks, who is Allah? How do you know Allah? You know, even question that we might not know an answer for. But at least encourage him to do it. And if you do give him an answer, if he asks a question and give him an answer that could lead him to another question too, to encourage him. And if you don't know the answer, just tell him, I don't know. You know, you really ask a very difficult question for me. Let us try to search it together and find out. So the child can actually feel that asking a question is good things, is not bad things. And the other one, also encourage them to do things of their own. If he wants to experiment, let him experiment, even if he fails. Because only through failures, the children can understand, yeah, not everything that you do will be successful, and that will help them actually how to handle difficult situation in the future. And at the same time, also strengthen their creativity. Obviously, you are not going to allow them to do an experiment that will hurt himself, because you know, when a children there always tell you, you have to, you know, to block to all of the electric, you know, plugs and so on, and sockets, and to try to protect the child, because the child wants to take something, also stick it in the electrical plug. So you have to, you know, you have to watch also for this. Experimentation is fine, but experimentation that treats physical harm, it is, you know, you have to be watchful for it in this case. Also need to watch, you know, but not to confuse two things, about college education and our graduate school and the curiosity. In fact, actually, some people argue that formal education, as we have it, it actually, you know, stifle curiosity and stifle innovation. Because what happened, kids sit and study and memorize. And unfortunately, that's what we find it in most Muslim countries, at least over in Egypt, which I did study. You know, the objective is to memorize what's in the books. No thinking at all. And after you finish the exam, you want to forget everything. It's almost like a robot or a computer, you know, in this regard. And this is, but they tell you the art of teaching, the good teacher, is the teacher who awaken this curiosity in the children, in the young minds. And then, therefore, the biggest crime education commit, that they rob the children out of this imagination, creativity, and curiosity. And that's something we have to watch for our children and our grandchildren. And actually, it's very interesting that you find out probably the most famous, you know, tech Mongols or tech, you know, scientists or tech, you know, people who we all know have never graduated from college. You know, look at these, you know, technology superstars like Bill Gates, Steve Jobs, Mark Zuckerberg. They never finished. They quit college. They never continued college. And look where they are now. And actually, Steve Jobs said this. He said, much of what I stumbled into by following my curiosity and intuition turned out to be a priceless later on. So it was his curiosity that let him arrive to this one. The other one, other interesting quote, he said that it's the first black woman to travel to space. And she was in the Endeavour, in the space shuttle, the Endeavour. And she is an engineer and a physician, you know. And I said, she's a young lady, actually. She said, don't let anyone rob you of your imagination, your creativity or your curiosity. It is your place in the world. It is your life. Go on and do all you can do with it and make it the life you want to live. And then Walt Disney, whom we all know, he said, ideas comes from curiosity. The other one, who is a well-known French poet and journalist, which is Anatole France, I think that's what I have his, here, he said, the whole art of teaching is the only art of awakening the natural curiosity of young mind for the purpose of satisfying it afterwards. And the curiosity itself can be vivid and wholesome only in proportion as the mind is contented and happy. Albert Einstein, who is the greatest scientist of the 20th century, he said, I am neither clever nor especially gifted. I am only very, very curious. And we know who is he. Another quote also, which was an interesting, and this is by, it's Bernard Brasch. Bernard Brasch was born in 1870 and died in 1965. And he was an American financier. And he actually was an economic advisor to several U.S. presidents, you know, Woodrow Wilson and Franklin Roosevelt. He said that millions saw the apple fall, but Newton is the only one who asked why. And now suddenly we know Newton is a curiosity from Newton sitting there. Everybody saw this happen millions of times. So now we also need to watch for something. There is, let us not confuse curiosity with encouragement of curiosity as part of Islam, as part of the teaching of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and as part of the teaching of his messenger, with the discouraging of Muslim from asking questions. Because sometimes people, you know, try to think, oh, that what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, don't ask questions. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam didn't want to ask questions. No, the Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam didn't want the Muslim to ask a question about the halal and the haram. Because this religion is so simple. It's so easy. Allah made everything as halal. And a few things Allah made clear haram. So Allah subhanahu doesn't want Muslim to be paranoid. And each time, is it halal, it's haram, it's halal or haram. So Allah subhanahu tell them in Surah Al-Ma'idah, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ أَمَنُوا لَا تَسْأَلُوا عَنْ أَشْيَاءٍ إِنْ تَبْدُوا لَكُمْ تَسُؤْكُمْ. If you ask it's halal or haram and the answer come to you, you will dislike it. You don't like it. So don't ask. إِن تَسْأَلُوا عَلَيَّ حِينَ يُنَزَّلُ الْقُرْآنُ تَبْدُ لَكُمْ. Because if you ask the Prophet at the time when the Quran was revealed and Allah answered, Allah will designate it halal or haram for you. And if it's haram, you are not going to like it. عَافَ اللَّهُ عَنْهَا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have pardoned you from it. He kept it halal for you. He's not going to set a rule for you on it. Then, and Allah is oft forgiven, most forbearing. So don't ask. And this is why I said, you know, there is also another hadith that I quoted before, which is Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas. And frankly, you see this, even Muslims these days do not heed this advice. Don't dig deeper in halal or haram. The halal is obvious and the haram is obvious. You know, don't try to find out what enzyme does come from the pig that go in toothpaste. And now the toothpaste you designated, you know, tell people watch for it. Even if you believe that enzyme have nothing to do with the halal or haram, you are not eating it. you just feel uncomfortable with it and make life difficult for everybody. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as narrated by Sa'd ibn Waqqas, and this is a very actually strong, you know, hadith, and this is narrated by Bukhari and the others. So he said, "Inna a'zam al-muslimin fil muslimin jurman." The most criminal Muslim among the Muslim. I mean, how worst this is, the one who did what? Is the one who commit adultery? Is the one who kills? No. من سأل عن شيء لم يحرم على المسلمين فحرم عليهم من أجل مسألتي. Who will ask about something that was not prohibited, but because of his question, Allah revealed it's haram and therefore became haram on them. That means what happened? He was the one who caused the constraint of Muslim. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala afa anha. Allah did not want to say anything about it and let Muslim, you know, take advantage of it, but now because of his question became haram. And then also there is many hadith actually on this. There is an Abu Darda. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, what Allah have made in his book lawful halal is halal, and what Allah forbidden is haram is haram, and what Allah was silent about, it is allowed as his favor. So accept from Allah his favors, because Allah would not forget anything, you know. And then also another hadith by Salman al-Farisi on the same theme, the halal is which Allah have made halal, and the haram is what Allah made haram, and that concerning things which Allah is silent about, he permitted as a favor for you. So accept the favors from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So let us not confuse the two issues about, you know, the all of the verses and the hadith that discourage Muslim, and what they said Muslim did not ask too many questions at that time. That is something completely different than being curious. And subhanallah also, you know, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make the Muslim not curious about these, you know, technical and scientific things. Because if they were asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would have answered them with a very proper scientific basis, they probably would be confused. And if he answered them in a way that is simplistic, we probably would have rejected it. So subhanallah, that could be also, you know, a part of the plan of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that this, the early Muslim, who in the knowledge basis and the science wasn't as developed as now, they did not ask all of these detailed questions. But now let me look now, and this, the verses, you know, from Surah Al-Baqarah, which I started with, which is Sayyidina Ibrahim, who when asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala how he resurrects, you know, from the dead, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him, bring these four sets of birds, four kind of birds, put, you know, every one of them in a different mountain and call them, and they will come to you. Now, as we said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't answer Sayyidina Ibrahim, be and become. And Sayyidina, that could happen, because actually the verses before actually tell also how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the verses just before this verse in Surah Al-Baqarah, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make the donkey, you know, for the man who died, you know, for 100 years become alive. And it could be and become. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't answer, didn't tell him this. Allah subhanahu give him an experiment, because Sayyidina Ibrahim wants to know the process. Even in B, there is a process. There is a steps are taken in this regard. Now, and as I said, through this, you know, experiment, Sayyidina Ibrahim understood. But I really wonder how many Muslims understand what Sayyidina Ibrahim understood. Obviously, we would never know what Sayyidina Ibrahim understood. But we can speculate. And the interesting part is that look at all the books of interpretation. Nothing on them authentic that's based on the hadith, on the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. All of it is speculation from them. And they speculate what kind of bird, he cut them. The verses doesn't say, you have to look at the verses the way it is. So if every interpreter of the Quran speculate what it is and give a story of his own, we have the right then to also speculate for something that might be convincing to us. And this is what I'm going to do here. And if you have, you can read it again and have another idea, then feel free to come and also present your idea. There is no monopoly on knowledge around here or ability to understand what is happening. But we have to understand something, that the concept of resurrection from death happen in front of us all the time. But we just don't notice it because it's a common practice for us. Common that we see it all the time. As an example, when you look at seeds, you look at seed and the seed, it looks like it's dead. You take it and store it. There is actually, they said in 2017, they found about 600,000 seed, which from this, you know, Silene stenophylla. And this discovered in a squirrel hibernation burrows near the banks of in Siberia. And this was the carbon dating for them show that these seeds were there for about 32,000 years ago. You think, oh, these seeds are dead, you know. But when they planted the seeds, they germinated. And there is another one, December 2009, 4,000 years old lentil seed was found in Turkey, and when they planted, it germinated. And 2005, 2,000 year old date palm tree, when also it was discovered from excavation in Palestine, that it was germinated and grown. So when we see things that we said a seed or, you know, that did, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bring it alive again, and it happened. How? We actually don't know. But it still we see it in front of us, you know, all the time. But we don't consider this intriguing, as I said, because we see it. It's common practice for us. And I said, you know, Sayyidina Ibrahim was curious about the process in which. And in it, there is, you know, a key word that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have used. He said, you know, خُذْ أَرْبَعَةٌ مِنَ الطَّيْرِ, four kind of birds, you know. فَصِرْهُنَّ إِلَيْكَ, فَصُرْهُنَّ إِلَيْكَ. This word, صُرْهُنَّ إِلَيْكَ, is important. What Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, take them and make these birds closer to you, come closer to you, that they become familiar with you, you know. He didn't tell him, take these four birds, cut them in four pieces, and then call them and they will come. No, there is a step before that he has to do. It's not just, because even the verses doesn't say he cut the birds. It doesn't say. He said, took juz, you know, four, فَخُذْ أَرْبَعَةٌ مِنَ الطَّيْرِ سُمَّجْ عَلَى كُلِّ جَبَلٍ مِنْهُنَّ جُزْءًا. Take juz, juz means part of these, not part of a bird, could be a part of a set of birds. Like sometimes we take, you know, If you are a teacher and they have a student and you said, take juz'i min the student, that doesn't mean take juz'i min the student, take part of the student. Doesn't take the student, cut them in pieces and take part of each one. No, take part means take part of the student. So the verse doesn't say any kid about killing, cutting or anything, you know, in this regard. But the word actually sir hunna comes, you know, fasur hunna ilayk. The word comes in too many verses, seven verses in the Quran, but all it means that insisting on something, doing something, you know, that basically resistance on it. You don't take these birds and just feed them for a while and then suddenly that's not surhunna. Surhunna means that you insisting in making them know you, make them closer to you. So it, you know, and there is a couple of verses, one surah, you know, there's so many verses actually. Ala Imran and Nuh, you can look, sir. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala dim those people who insist on rejecting the message, you know, and said asarru. Asarru means they are insistent, resistance in rejecting the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And actually, then we ask, why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took birds? Why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala take him to, you know, to chickens or something else, you know? Why birds specifically? And there's an interest, subhanAllah, because birds are not, you know, it's hard to tame birds to human being. Each time you approach a bird, the bird flies away from you. So it's difficult to actually to get the birds to become, you know, to know you and recognize you. It takes a lot of time
to do this. And the people who see, like some of the Arabs in the Gulf of Emirates and so on, train falcons. It takes a lot of time for the falcons, you know, to train the falcons. So when the person let him go and call him, the falcon comes and stand in his hand. So birds does not have affinity to man. And therefore Allah subhanahu wants to tell him there is something about closeness and affinity. That, and then if you look at this, you know, when we look at it, what is in us? What is in the human being? The human being has what? Has a body which is made of earth and has a soul, has a, you know, a ruh. So in this case, is there is affinity between the ruh that comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the body that came from dirt, from dust, from earth? No, there is no affinity between them. You know, they are as far apart as you could. And this is why, in order to get the ruh to go in the body, either Allah subhanahu have to do it himself, as he did it in Sayyidina Ibrahim, or have to send an angel to do it in the womb of the mother for every child. Because it's not natural for them to be together. And this is why, as we know in the hadith, for hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which is Bukhari and Muslim, that Allah subhanahu wa creation of everyone is brought together in his mother womb for 40 days in the form of, you know, of nutfa, and the same thing as alaqa, and then the same as a mudgha, another 40 days. Summa yursil Allahu al-malak fayanfukhu fihi ar-ruh. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send the angel to blow in him the soul. The soul would not come by itself and connect to him. It needs something to put it together, resistance to keep it together, because they don't have affinity to each other, because one comes from very high, you know, and one comes from the very low part that comes from the earth is very low. So here is, there is no affinity between them, and that is why Allah subhanahu have to put the soul in the earthly matter, in the womb of the mother, so that soul become familiar with the composition and the construction of every cell in that human body. And now you can look and say, what is a human body? Who are we? You know, first of all, if you look, you know, to the human body is assembled of what? Atom. You and I are, as we said, atoms, and atoms, which is the cells become, is actually an atom. And they said the most atoms that exist in the human body is these six, is the oxygen, carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen, calcium, and phosphorus. And they, you know, and the oxygen alone, imagine this, your body has 65% of it oxygen atoms. Now, what is this oxygen atom? What's the atom? The atom, if they tell you, if I take a, you know, an atom obviously has a nucleus, you know, and everybody knew this, has a nucleus and have electrons. You know, if you think about it, if the nucleus is like a basketball, where is the electrons? The electron, they tell you, 2 miles away. You know. So if you live 2 miles away, if you are an atom in you, you will be like sitting here, and the part that related to you is in your home, which is the, you know, the electrons. What is in between? It's between an empty space. So in reality, we are all empty spaces. You know, the only thing that will hold us together is actually this electromagnetic force. Otherwise, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala suspended this electromagnetic force, we all be nothing. We just be fall as a dust, you know, in the ground. So that is why now this one, now when we said, now bring the soul into the body which don't have affinity, what is the soul will understand all of these things, the connection between them, how to make the cell, how to make the human body out, which is a human body. At the end of the day, it just comes from atoms. Now, the other one, which is an interesting about the resurrection, actually, the process of resurrection happened to us all the time. and we are not aware of it. Because they tell you like a human body has between 50 to 75 trillion cells. And each cell, which is cells, I said, made of atoms, each cell has a lifespan. So in reality, continuously, we are changing. My cells die and the new cells comes in. What makes it that cell is the cell like the cell of my, you know, ear dies, another cell comes in. How do you know that, why the cell that comes in, it become an ear and doesn't become something else? And they said also that every 7 to 10 years, the whole body, all human body, is replaced by another body. In reality, we get some time each other, like, you know, when your cells or atoms get rejected and your cell dies, I might take part of it in me, and you might take part of it in you. So the end of the day, we all made of each other. Because where is these atoms will come from? And that's why the sense of brotherhood actually is not only spiritual brotherhood, it's actually physical brotherhood. So my life is, you know, depending on you, and your life is depending on me, if we really think about it. And this is what, you know, what I am now speculating. I'm saying what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have demonstrated to Sayyidina Ibrahim, that yes, as much as the birds did not have affinity to you, but if you bring them closer with resistance to know you, when you call them, they will come to you. And the same thing as your earthly body and your soul. The soul never dies. The soul, I put him in the body at early phase of the human development, so it can learn about all of the construction of it. So all of what the soul is, call these atoms to come in, and the atoms will become and put together in the algorithm that the soul knows into the new human body. And that is how you are going to come back as a human, resurrect. And this is why, you know, that is what I'm speculating that Sayyidina Ibrahim understood. And if you have a different, you know, idea, then in this case, you are welcome to come think about it and come with another explanation to look at the process. Allahumma salli wa sallim wa barik ala Sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Allahumma adina fi man hadayt wa afina fi man afayt wa tawallana fi man tawallayt wa barik Allahumma lana fi ma a'tayt wa qina wasrif anna sharra ma qadayt innaka ya Rabbana taqdi bil haqq wa la yuqda alayk. اللهم اصلح لنا ديننا الذي هو عصمة أمرنا واصلح لنا دنيانا التي فيها معاشنا واصلح لنا آخرتنا التي إليها مردنا اللهم اجعل الحياة زادا لنا من كل خير واجعل الموت راحة لنا من كل شر اللهم ادخلنا برحمتك في عبادك الصالحين اللهم اخرجنا من ظلمات الجهل والوهم إلى نور العلم اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما اللهم أرنا الحق حقا فاجعلنا وارزقنا اتباعه وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه اللهم اجعلنا ممن يستمعون القول فيتبعون أحسنه اللهم اكفنا بحلالك عن حرامك وبطاعتك عن معصيتك وفضلك عن من سواك اللهم بفضلك ورحمتك أعلي كلمة الحق والدين اللهم انصر الإسلام وعز المسلمين يا أكرم الأكرمين Oh Allah, spread your mercy upon us, shower us with your blessing, increase our knowledge, grant us forgiveness and reward us with the company of the prophets in the Firdaus al-A'la Oh Allah, purify our heart, strengthen our faith, increase our knowledge and make us benefit from what you have taught us Oh Allah, remedy our sick Oh Allah, give all our sick family members and all family members and all friends from this masjid and all the believers and every human being who is sick, give them a fast and speedy and full recovery. Oh Allah, forgive our parents and all the believers and grant them the Firdaus al-A'la. Oh Allah, guide our children, protect them and make them righteous. Oh Allah, accept our repentance, wash our sins, answer our supplication, establish our evidence and guide our heart. Oh Allah, we seek from you all of the good, whether we know it or we don't. And we seek your refuge from all evil, whether we know it or we don't. Oh Allah, we ask with every name you have elected for yourself, that none of us leave this gathering, but his pains have been relieved, his worries have been removed, his debts have been paid, his weaknesses have been concealed, his sins have been forgiven and his needs have been fulfilled. Subhanallah wa bihamdih, adad khalqih wa rida nafsih wa zinat arshih wa midada kalimatih. Subhanallah wa bihamdih, adad khalqih wa rida nafsih wa zinat arshih wa midada kalimatih. Subhanallah wa bihamdih, adad khalqih wa rida nafsih wa zinat arshih wa midada kalimatih. Wal asr, innal insana lafi khusr. إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على خير المرسلين اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.